Hey, welcome. Today we're going to tackle one of those big, important numbers you always hear about in the news, gross domestic product, or GDP. We're going to break down what it is, how we even calculate it, and maybe more importantly, what it really tells us about how a country is doing. Let's dive in.
I mean, think about it for a second. That's a huge question, right? How on earth do you take all the activity of millions of people, all the things being made, all the services being offered, and boil it all down into a single, meaningful number? Well, that is the exact puzzle economists are trying to solve.
So here's our game plan. First, we're going to build a tiny little economy right from scratch, just to see how it works. Then we'll figure out its GDP and see if it's growing. After that, we'll throw a bit of a curveball into the mix with something I'm calling the per capita puzzle. And finally, we'll connect it all back to what it means in the real world.
Okay, so to really get our heads around this, let's just create our own little fictional economy. No complex global supply chains. No confusing financial markets. For now, our economy produces exactly three things. That's it.
So, check this out. This is our economy in the year 2009. We make 5,000 of product X, and they each sell for $4. We make 2,000 of product Y, which go for $2 each. And we've got a fancy product Z. We only make 1,000 of those, but they sell for $10 a piece. And that's the key. For everything we make, we know how much we made and what it sells for.
All right, now for the main event, calculating the gross domestic product. This is the big number, the one that's supposed to capture the total value of everything our little economy cranked out in 2009.
Now, the official textbook definition of GDP is what you see here. The total market value of all finished goods and services produced inside a country in a certain amount of time. Basically, it's just the total cash value of all the final stuff, all our X, Y, and Z that we produced in 1 year.
And you know what? The math to figure this out is actually super simple. For every single product, you just multiply how much you made, the quantity, by its price. This formula might look a little fancy with that sigma symbol, but all that really means is add it all up.
So let's plug in our numbers. For product X, that's 5,000 times 4, which gives us 20,000. For product Y, it's 2,000 times 2, so that's 4,000. And for our pricey product Z, 1,000 times 10 gives us 10,000. So you take those three values, you add them all together, and boom! There it is! The GDP for our economy in 2009 is 34,000. That's it. We've just put a single number on our entire economy's output for the year.
Okay, so 34,000. Cool. But so what? A single number by itself doesn't really tell you much. What we really care about is change. Is that number going up or down? Did the economy actually grow? Let's jump ahead to 2010 and see what's up.
All right, so in 2010, things are looking good. Our little economy is humming. We're making 10% more of product X, 5% more of product Y, and a huge 20% more of product Z. Now, here's a really important detail. The prices didn't change at all. And this is key, because it means any growth we see is real growth. We're actually making more stuff, not just charging more for it.
So, time to crunch the numbers for 2010. That 10% boost for product X brings its value to 22,000. Product Y's little 5% bump takes it to 4,200. And that big 20% jump for product Z brings its value to 12,000. So our new total GDP is 38,200. It's bigger, for sure, but how much bigger exactly?
Well, to figure that out, there's another pretty simple formula. You just take the new GDP, divide it by the old one, subtract 1, and then multiply the whole thing by 100 to get a nice clean percentage.
And when we plug our numbers into that formula, we get a growth rate of 12.35%. Now let me tell you, in the real world, that is an insane amount of growth for 1 year. Most big countries are thrilled with 2 or 3%. So our little economy is absolutely on fire. But does that automatically mean everyone is better off?
And this is where the story gets really interesting. See, having a bigger economic pie is great, but what if there are suddenly way more people who need a slice of that pie? This brings up a whole new, crucial idea.
So let's introduce another piece of information. Let's say in 2009, our population was 1,000 people. But a year later, in 2010, it jumped all the way to 1,250. Whoa, that's a 25% jump in population. That changes the picture completely.
This is why economists don't just stop at GDP. They look at something called GDP per capita. Per capita is just a fancy Latin way of saying per person or per head.
It's a way to measure the average piece of the economic pie for each person. And guess what? The formula is, once again, super straightforward. You just take your total GDP for the year and divide it by the number of people in your country. Let's see what that does to our numbers. Okay, let's do the math. In 2009, we had a GDP of 34,000 for 1,000 people. That's a GDP per capita of 34. Simple. But in 2010, our bigger GDP of 38,200 now has to be split among 1,250 people, and that gives us 30.56. Wait, what? Look at that. The GDP per person is lower. Even though the whole economy grew, the average person's share of that economy actually went down. This chart makes it crystal clear. The bar for 2010 is shorter. The GDP per capita fell. Now, why did that happen? It's simple, but it's so important. Our population grew by a whopping 25%, but our economy only grew by about 12%. The population growth outpaced the economic growth. So, on average, everybody's individual slice of the pie got smaller.
Okay, so we've played around with our little pretend economy. Now let's bring this all back to the real world, because this concept is absolutely critical for understanding how countries are actually doing.
So why do we obsess over this number GDP per capita? Well, this quote really nails it. It's basically used as a shorthand, a quick way to get a rough idea of a country's average standard of living. The thinking is simple. If a country produces more stuff per person, then on average, each person probably has more income and access to more things.
To put a real number on this, let's take a look at Israel. Its recent GDP per capita was approximately $51,000. Now, out of all the countries in the world, that puts it somewhere in the top 20, which is considered a very high standard of living. That single number helps us compare the economic well-being of one nation to another.
And that leads us to our final and maybe most important takeaway. Because you have to remember, GDP per capita is just an average. It tells you nothing about how that economic pie is actually sliced up. You could have a few people with enormous slices and a lot of people with just tiny crumbs. So that leaves us with a really big question. If a country's total wealth, or even its average wealth, doesn't tell the whole story, what else should we be looking at? What other numbers matter? That is definitely something to think about.
Hey everyone, welcome. So today, we're going to pop the hood on the entire economy and see what makes the engine run. You know, it's one of the biggest questions out there. What actually drives economic growth over the long haul? Let's get right into it.
So just stop and think about this for a second. I mean, it's easy to see how one company gets better at making, say, one thing. But how does a whole country, an entire economy, produce more of, well, everything? How do we all, together, get more cars, better software, more healthcare, you name it, all at once? It feels kind of like magic, right? But believe me, it's not. It's actually all about a few core ideas we're going to break down.
Okay, to really get our heads around this, economists have this really cool visual tool. It's called the Production Possibility Curve, or PPC for short. Now, just picture this curve as the absolute maximum, the outer limit of what an economy can possibly produce right now with everything it has. So for real growth to happen, we can't just shuffle things around inside that boundary. Nope, we have to push the whole boundary line outward. And figuring out how to do that, that's what this is all about. So, where do we even begin? Well, it all starts with the most basic, most important part of any economy. People. Us. And look, this isn't just about having more bodies, more workers. It's about making every single person more effective at what they do. Economists have a term for this. They call it investing in human capital. Fancy term, simple idea. When we invest in things like education, job training, you know, skills, we're basically upgrading the entire economic engine. A smarter, more skilled workforce is a more productive workforce. It's that simple. They tackle tougher problems. They come up with new solutions. I mean, just look at a place like South Korea. They totally transformed their economy in just a few decades. And a massive part of that was a huge investment in education. That's this idea in the real world, plain and simple. But, you know, even the smartest, most skilled people in the world can't do much without the right tools and the right setup. And that brings us right to our next big piece of the puzzle. The actual physical stuff that makes an economy work. And this really breaks down into two big categories. First up, you've got what we call physical capital. This is all the tangible stuff, the machines, the factories, the computers, the buildings, everything we use to actually make things. Then you've got infrastructure. Think of this as the veins and arteries of the economy, the roads, the ports, the power grid, and of course, the internet.
It's all the stuff that connects everything and everyone, letting business happen smoothly. Okay, but here's the really crucial part. These two things, investing in people and investing in stuff, they're not separate. They're totally connected. Think about it. Investing in human capital, in people, makes them more efficient. But investing in physical capital gives those smarter people way better tools to work with. It's like a 1-2 punch. You really need both for it to have a massive impact. One without the other just doesn't pack the same power. All right, so we've got smart, skilled people, and we've given them great tools. That's a fantastic start. But there is a third ingredient, a sort of wild card that can completely change the game. And that, my friends, is the power of a new idea. This is really where technology comes in and shines. Because technology is, for all intents and purposes, a massive multiplier, a single breakthrough. It could be a new piece of software, a more fuel-efficient engine, anything. It lets us produce more with the exact same amount of resources. Suddenly, you don't need more people or more factories. You just need a smarter way of doing things. This is the stuff that doesn't just nudge that economic boundary line, it blows it wide open. Okay, so we have our three core ingredients, right? People, tools, and ideas. But here's the thing. They don't just work in isolation. They feed off each other in this incredibly powerful self-reinforcing loop. Think of that like a giant flywheel. Let's walk through how it gets spinning. So imagine this flywheel. It all starts with educated, skilled people. That's our human capital. What do? Well, they come up with new ideas and innovations. Boom, that's technology. Then those new ideas are used to build better tools, better machines, better infrastructure. And what's the final result? When you put those skilled people together with those better tools that came from those new ideas, productivity just explodes. And that right there is how you get real, sustainable economic growth. See how each step pushes the next? It just keeps building on itself. Look, if you take away just one single thing today, let it be this. You can boil this whole thing down to a super simple formula. Growth equals people plus tools plus ideas. That's it. At the end of the day, it's all about investing in people, giving them great tools, and creating a space for new ideas to happen. People, tools, ideas. That's the secret sauce. So you see, even though economics can seem like it's all about complicated charts and numbers, the real story of growth is, well, it's really human, isn't it? It's a story about us, about learning new things, building better stuff, and coming up with brilliant ideas. It's not some kind of magic trick. It's a process, one that we have to actively nurture. And that brings us to a really interesting question, looking forward. We know this combo of people, tools, and ideas has worked for centuries. But now, technology, especially something like AI, is accelerating at a mind-bending pace. So what do you think? Which piece of that puzzle is going to be the most critical driver in the future? Will it always be about people, or are we entering an age where our ideas and the tools they create finally take over? Definitely something to chew on. Thanks so much for joining me.